जी अस्सलाम वालेकुम। नाउ वी कंटिन्यू विद आवर स्पेशल एम्ब्रियोलॉजी। वी हैव डिस्कस्ड द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ द स्कल, मैंडिबल, द हायोइड बोन। देन वी टॉक्ड अबाउट अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक दैट वाज योर फरेंजियल एपरेटस, दैट इज गिविंग राइज टू फ्रॉम ऑल द फोर एरियाज, दैट इज क्लेफ्ट्स, आर्चेस, पाउचेस एंड मेम्ब्रेन्स, द डिफरेंट स्ट्रक्चर्स डिवेलपिंग इनटू द नेक पोर्शन। Then we go on to something which is going to develop from the floor adiverticulum or the arches, which is going to be contributed from the pharyngeal arches. That is a very important topic, that is the development of the tongue and the development of the thyroid gland, that is from the floor of the pharyngeal pouches. Now in this thing, the important thing is when you develop the tongue, you should recollect the nerve supply of the tongue. What different areas are getting its nerve supply from where? That is, what is sensory, what is general sensory, what is motor, and all these nerve supplies, because that is going to reflect back to the origin of your tongue. So now, starting with this, the area that we are going to talk about is roughly at the level of this foramen cecum. If you can see in this picture, that is roughly between the junction of the second and the you can say first and the second arch pouch, rather, because this is the floor of the pharyngeal apparatus or the pharynx lemon. So this is where we are going to talk about and where we are going to form the tongue and the thyroid gland. When we talk about the development of the tongue, what all we have to talk about is the mucous membrane, the muscles which are going to develop, and the fibroareolar stroma, that is the area of the bulk of the tongue covering with the mucous membrane, and then the muscles which are going to be in there, and then the fibroareolar stroma. First of all is the mucous membrane, which is going to develop on top. First thing that is going to form the bulk of the tongue, that is going to be from the, going to start from the fourth week of the development, that is in the floor of the primordial pharynx, and that point is where we have the foramen cecum. That is, not at the moment we're talking about something, an area which is in front of the foramen cecum. This is the part which is at the level of your first pharyngeal arch. So they are going to rise certain swellings, which we are going to then unite together and then give rise to the different parts. In this, at the moment, the first swelling that is going to arise is one median swelling, as you can see in this picture, that is in the center. That is what we, because it's going to be related with the tongue, so we call it the lingual swelling. So we see one medial lingual swelling, because there's just one swelling at the first pharyngeal arch, that is roughly it's going to be the mesenchymal component. That is what we call as the tuberculum impar. It is given the name as tuberculum impar. And then on its side, again from the first arch, we have two lateral swellings, which are called the two lateral lingual swellings, again from the first arch. Proliferation goes on in these lateral lingual swellings, then they grow, fuse, the lateral lingual swellings fuse together and form the interior two-thirds of the tongue, whereas the median swelling that finishes off at the tuberculum impar disappears. So three swellings appear in the first pharyngeal arch, that is two lateral swellings and one median swelling. The lateral swellings, if you see in this central swelling is what we call as the tuberculum impar, and these are the two lateral lingual swellings. These two lateral lingual swellings, they are going to progress, grow together, come and meet together, and the tuberculum impar displaces, and then this is going to form the body or the interior two-thirds of the tongue. So this interior two-thirds of the tongue is developing from your first pharyngeal arch. So this area is going to get its nerve supply, the sensory nerve supply. First pharyngeal arch nerve supply is your trigeminal nerve, and from the trigeminal, this is the mandibular nerve in this area, which is going to supply to this, that is the sensory area. So because it is a derivative of the first, I remember I told you, whatever structure is going to develop from a certain arch is going to get its same nerve supply. So because this part of the interior two-thirds of the tongue is developing from the in first pharyngeal arch, it's going to get its nerve supply, which is from your trigeminal nerve. In this case, it is your mandibular branch, right? So this diffuse together and form the interior two-thirds of the tongue, which is also called the body of the tongue or the oral part of the tongue, and the tuberculum impar or the median swelling that is going to disappear. where the two lateral swellings are going to be together, that is going to form the medial sulcus or the median sulcus, which you can see on the top of the tongue or on the dorsal surface of the tongue. That is the site where the two lateral lingual swellings have fused together. That is called the median sulcus. And in between, separating the two median sulcus, is the internal fibrous lingual septum, which is just a median partition which is separating the two lateral components. So this is the formation of the interior two-thirds. That is the first arch, and this is going to get its nerve supply from the nerve supply of the first arch. Then is the posterior one-third part. This part is called the pharyngeal part, or part which is caudal to the foramen cecum. If you see again, they have shown you the foramen cecum in this diagram. There are going to be, that is second, third, and the fourth arches. These three are concerned. The second arch shows you a swelling, which is what we call as the copula. That is a swelling posterior to the foramen cecum, that is called the copula. Then another swelling with the junction, between the junction of the third and the fourth, you have another swelling, that is a composition of third and the fourth arch, that is called the hypobranchial eminence. The hypobranchial eminence. So three swellings appear on the, or the three arches, they contribute. First is a swelling, what we call as the copula, that is the proliferation of your second pharyngeal arch, that is called the copula. And then the third and the fourth, if you can see in this green diagram, that is the hypobranchial eminence. Then this hypobranchial eminence takes a major role in forming the posterior part of the tongue. This overgrows and it covers the copula. So copula disappears. In that, your tuberculum impar disappears, and posteriorly it is the copula, that is from the second one, it disappears. So remember, what is the nerve supply of the second arch, the third arch, and the fourth arch? So because we're going to fit in the nerve supply of these respective areas. So this overgrows and copula disappears. So posterior third is going to be formed by your hypopharyngeal eminence. And then the junction between the anterior two-thirds and the posterior one-third is your sulcus terminalis. So your interior part, that is the body, is going to be formed from the first arch by the two lateral medial swellings, and the posterior third is, or the pharyngeal part, is going to be formed by the majority portion is by the third and the fourth arch. Copula disappears and the median swelling disappears. Then the mucous membrane, which is going to cover this mesenchymal growth, that is at the interior two-thirds oral part, is the lateral lingual swellings. So that is going to be again your first arch. And the posterior third part, that is your pharyngeal part, root, or the hypobranchial eminence. So this is, I'm stressing this again and again, because we have to remember the nerve supply of these areas, and from the where do these swellings arise, and these swellings are going to get its nerve supply from that respective areas. So if you see in this diagram, this brownish part, that is coming from the first, and this fourth part of this small portion, that is second, this I'll tell you how this diagram is there. And then the pharyngeal part, that is the posterior third. So interior two-thirds is the oral part, that is by the first, and then this posterior one-third is by the hypobranchial eminence. So you see again in this diagram, this interior two-thirds, the first part, then the second, the posterior third, that is behind the foramen cecum, is the root of the tongue, that is coming from the second. Mostly the second is overgrown, so you do not contribute, so you're going to get a nerve supply from the fascia. It is the third and the fourth which are going to contribute. If you see in this, the copula, the first picture, that is the copula, second arch, the third and the fourth is the hypobranchial eminence, and then behind that you have the beginning of your laryngeal orifice. That was the parts of it, and then the endoderm, that is the mucous membrane covering it, that comes from the endoderm, because your pouches are endoderm. Then is the fibroareolar stroma, that is the pharyngeal arch mesenchyme in it, is going to give you the connective tissue and the vasculature. That is, the mesenchyme from these areas is going to give you the stroma. Then is the muscles of the tongue. The muscles of the tongue, they come from the myotomes. These first four occipital myotomes, they disappear. The rest of these myotomes, you see in this diagram, these occipital myotomes, they have been marked separately, and the rest of it, they are going to give the cervical ones. They are going to give rise to the muscles of the tongue, and this is going to be supplied by the hypoglossal nerve. So that is the muscles of the tongue. When you talk about the development, you have to talk about the bulk of it. that is, and then you have to talk about the mucous membrane, and then you have to talk about the muscle. So all these components have to be discussed when you're talking about the development. Then we've talked about the broad body, that is the bulk of the tongue. We've talked about the end of the connective tissue portion. We've talked about the mucous membrane. We've talked about the muscle. What is left, if you see, that is what is called as, if you collectively talk about, that is what we call as histogenesis. If you talk about each and every structure separately, the histogenesis is the pharyngeal arch mesenchyme that is gives rise to the connective tissue and the vasculature. Occipital myotomes gives rise to your tongue muscles. The endoderm gives rise to your mucosa. Then we have these lingual papilla on the surface of the tongue. You have done the tongue by now so that you know the different structures. By the end of the 8th week, you start the development of the lingual papilla. Every development, this starts around roughly 4th week, but at the end of the 8th week, you have the lingual papilla. There are 4 types of papilla which are going to develop. First is your palate and the foliate papilla. These are going to arise at the area where you have the 3rd arch, that is where you have the fibers of the glossopharyngeal nerve. So they are going to arise in that area, that is the palate and the foliate. So it is roughly at the level where you have your circumvallate, the trench which is there, that is your sulcus terminalis, and behind that is your 3rd one. So it is roughly at that site that these two, the palate and the foliate papilla, are going to arise. Then you have the fungiform papilla. These are going to arise where you have the nerve supply, chorda tympani of the facial nerve, and that is roughly at the area where you have the 2nd arch. That is, so palate and foliate papilla are going to arise in the area of the 3rd arch, and fungiform papilla are going to arise in the area of the 2nd arch. All this is going to be related with the nerve supply as well. 10th to 11th week, the filiform, which are sensitive to touch, they are going to arise. Taste buds arise from 11th to 13th week by the induction of the epithelial cells and then wearing nerve fibers on the dorsal surface. So you can say each and every papilla nearly has the taste buds. And lingual tonsil, which is at the root of the tongue, on the posterior 3rd of the tongue. So that is all the components. That is your connective tissue, your muscles, your mucous membrane, the bulk, that is from the arches, and your lingual papilla. So these are all the components which you have to talk about when you are talking about the development of the tongue. So this collectively is going to form the tongue. If you see this, the median sulcus, where your medial and the lateral, the two lateral swellings are going to be, then this loose line is your terminal sulcus, junction of anterior 2/3 to posterior 3rd, and then this is the junction where you are having the formation of the circumvallate papilla. This is roughly the area where you have the 3rd arch. The 1, 3, 4th is the numbering of the arches. So this circumvallate papilla are arising in the area of the glossopharyngeal nerve, so they're going to have the nerve supply from the glossopharyngeal nerve. Now coming on to the nerve supply, collecting all the nerves and all the areas of development, and automatically we put 2 and 2 together. First is the sensory nerve supply. The sensory nerve supply of the anterior 2, the general sensory, is going to be the trigeminal, which is your mandibular nerve. Then is the special sensory, that is chorda tympani, your facial nerve. This is going to give fibers to your taste buds, though not much of it is being formed by the facial nerve, but this is said to form the, it's part of this is overgrown, or it reflects on to the anterior 2/3. That is why this gets its nerve supply. The taste buds, they get its nerve supply from the facial nerve. Only your palate papilla, which we had in the area of the 3rd one, they are not going to get its nerve supply from the facial, but they're going to have its nerve supply from the glossopharyngeal nerve. Then is the posterior 1/3. General and special, both posterior 1/3 area is because it is the 3rd and the 4th, and we said the 2nd part disappeared. So this part is going to get its general supply from the glossopharyngeal nerve, and the posterior most part, which is your 3rd and the 4th, that is your part which is supplied by your vagus nerve. So the posterior most part is going to get its nerve supply from the vagus nerve, because we have 3rd and the 4th. 3rd is glossopharyngeal area, so that, and the posterior most part is going to be the 4th, is going to have its vagus nerve. The motor nerve supply, hypoglossal nerve, except because from the occipital myotomes, it's going to get a hypoglossal nerve, except palatoglossus, which is going to come from the pharyngeal plexus, which is a contribution from the vagus. So this is how you put 2 and 2 together, how what areas give rise to what part and what nerve supply is coming to it. So you should remember, first arch is trigeminal, second arch is facial nerve, third arch is glossopharyngeal, fourth and sixth is your vagus nerve. Now, why does the posterior part get its nerve supply from the facial nerve? That is because some part of it, they say that it covers the taste part. And then the circumvallage papillae, but they are at the junction. But it is said that some part of the third arch that extends forward at the level of your glossopharyngeal nerve, where you have the circumvallage papillae, that is why giving rise to the nerve supply of the circumvallage papillae as glossopharyngeal nerve. So it extends forward onto the, roughly to the junction. As you can see, the junction of the anterior and the posterior parts is roughly at the level of the second. So this is by the extension of the third arch structure onto this level of the circumvallate papillae. And so that is where the circumvallate papillae are going to get its nerve supply from the third arch or the glossopharyngeal nerve. So that is how you distribute. And then the chorda tympani does not give any nerve supply except only to your taste fibers. And that is the special sensations onto the anterior portion. That is also just to the taste buds, because no part is being formed from the second arch. So no part is being supplied. It's only your taste buds which are getting its nerve supply. That is your special sensations from the chorda tympani. So these are the explanations why a certain circumvallate papillae is getting its nerve supply from the glossopharyngeal, and why chorda tympani is not giving any nerve supply, because it does not contribute to the formation. I think it's just your taste buds which are getting its nerve supply. That is just the extension, and that is the contact between the epithelial cells and your nerve fibers of the facial nerve. By their interaction, it is going to develop into these lingual papillae, and which is going to give it nerve fibers. That was the development of the tongue. Let's recollect how it is formed. Okay, so we are going to develop the mucous membrane, or the bulk of it. That is first arch, that is anterior two-thirds, by the central one portion, that is the median swelling, tubercular mempar, and then the two lateral swellings. These two lateral swellings overgrow and they meet together and they form the anterior two-thirds, median disappears. So this part. And then behind the foramen cecum, you have from the second part, what is developed is called the copula, and the part from the third and the fourth, that is the hypobranchial eminence. Copula is going to disappear, and the posterior third is basically behind the sulcus terminalis is going to be your the posterior third part from the hypobranchial eminence. The mucous membrane, anterior two-third, but from the lateral lingual swellings, that is the first arch, and the posterior one-third is basically third and the so it is going to get its endoderm from these areas. You see in this picture, you see all these swellings, lateral swellings, tubercular mempar, copula, and the hypobranchial eminence. And then you have the epiglottic swelling. Pharyngeal arch, connective tissue, vasculature, the muscles of the tongue, they come from the myotomes, which is supplied by the hypoglossal nerve. So these are the different areas which are going to, and how the papilla are going to develop and what nerves each papilla is going to get. And the taste buds. Then coming on to this summary, the contribution from all arches which changes with time begins as swelling rostral to foramen cecum, median tongue bud, or the tubercular mempar. Part 1 is oral part, that is the anterior two-thirds. Arch 2 is the initial contribution to the surfaces lost, that is your tubercular mempar. Arch 3, pharyngeal part of the tongue, posterior one-third. Arch 4, that is epiglottis and the adjacent regions that give rise. So these are all the contributions. We again said that the first arch, the oral part of the tongue, the two, that is your copula, disappears. It's the third and the fourth which are going to give rise to your tongue. Then coming on to the malformations or the anomalies of the development of the tongue. Very uncommon, but still you can see certain ones, that is fissuring of the tongue, that is certain cleft-like structures or cuts on the tongue that can be seen. That is then papillary hypertrophy, that is the papilla, the lingual papilla, they can be increased in size. It is said that they're commonly seen as a sign of Down syndrome, that is the chromosomal abnormality. Then you can have congenital lingual cysts or fistula. This is when we talk about the thyroid gland, that is just next to it. That is the remnants. Some parts of that thyroglossal duct are called the lingual, or some is the hypolingual. This is a remnant of the thyroglossal duct is going to be called as, because lingual is related with the tongue, so that is why we say this is one of the anomalies of the tongue, that you form a cyst. That is the remnant of the thyroglossal duct, which has to disappear, is going to form a cyst. And if this cyst structures and you have a communication between the inside of the pharynx with the outside on the skin, that is going to form a fistula. So that can be there. Macroglossia, that is a big sized tongue. Generalized, if there is hypertrophy of the structure of the tongue, you can get a macroglossia. Microglossia is microgonathia. Microgonathia is when there is small face development. The mouth has developed, the bones have developed small, all the structures, your mouth opening is small, or the mouth cavity is small. That results into microglossia because the tongue has no place to develop. Then there can be a bifid or a cleft tongue, that is at the center where there is fusion of the lateral two swellings. If they do not fuse completely from end to end, they have a sort of a cleft at their anterior end. That is what we call as bifid or cleft tongue. It is also called snake tongue because it is said that the tongue of the snakes is bifid from the anterior end. That is because of the malformation or the malunion of the two lateral lingual swellings. You see this ankyloglossia or the tongue tie. Your tongue is attached to the floor of the mouth by a short frenum or the fibrous tissue. That is, it holds it to the tongue, so excessive movements are not. At times, this frenulum that is attached till the tip of the tongue. That means your tongue cannot move properly, and it is sort of said to be a tied tongue. So that is why we call it ankyloglossia. It's this frenum, which is shown in this small fold of mucous membrane, it extends to the tip, connects inferior surface of the tongue to the floor of the mouth, and affects free protrusion. That means your tongue is held from end to end to the floor of the mouth, and you cannot protrude out your tongue. The baby cannot protrude out, and so he speaks in a very monotone or very tone which you cannot understand. This is said that it is of no issue, but it stretches with its time. That means this frenum becomes small and the tongue develops, and the tongue can move freely. But at times, this does not develop and the child is not speaking clearly. You can give it a cut, that is, a small surgery is done at times, and you give this frenum a small cut so that your tongue is freed from this attachment at the floor, and so the child can move his tongue. So that is what we call as tongue tie. That means your tongue is tied to the floor of the oral cavity. But this is of no clinical significance. This itself stretches and removes the problem, or what you need is something that you give it a small cut and the tongue is freed from the end and it can move forward. So these are the abnormalities which can occur of the tongue, developing tongue. So fissures can occur, papilla can hypertrophy, cysts can form, macroglossia, microglossia, bifid tongue, or this tongue tie. Next is the development of the thyroid gland. This is also in relation to the area where you have the floor of the pharynx, and that is in the pouch area. So thyroid gland is said to be the first endocrine gland to develop 24 days after fertilization. So you should know that first gland, endocrine gland to develop is after 24 days of fertilization is your thyroid gland. We've already talked about the parathyroid gland. If you see this again in the floor and you see the diagram, that is the first arch, mandibular, second arch, third arch, that was in front, you had the tuberculum, that is the site where you start developing. That was your tuberculum impar in front of the this foramen cecum, and behind is the papilla. The first to develop in the fourth week, floor of the pharynx between the first and the second arches, just bordered to the median tongue swelling. That is this area, this small swelling, endodermal thickening becomes an outpocketing, that is called your thyroid diverticulum. So at this level where you have the foramen magnum, the foramen cecum, there you have a small protrusion, endodermal protrusion, which extends downwards, and that is what is the starting point of the development of the thyroid gland, and this is labeled as thyroid diverticulum. This picture just shows you at the site where the development starts. If you see this picture, there are these a side view, that is, there are the different arches which are seen, and then you have the, from the pharynx back, you have the esophagus, then you have the opening of the oral cavity, then you have the heart. Thyroid first endocrine to develop in the embryo of 24 days after fertilization develops from a medial endodermal thickening in the floor of this primordial pharynx. If you see this, soon forms a small outpocketing that is called your thyroid primordium. If you see in this diagram, this is an outpocketing from the floor, that is a protrusion that is forming a pouch that is called your thyroid primordium. This picture shows you from where it starts to develop. This diverticulum is then going to extend downwards. From the floor at this diverticulum, this is going to extend downwards. This is first a hollow diverticulum, then it's going to become solid. This then extends downward, reaching to the front of the neck at the level of the thyroid cartilage. Then it's going to divide into two, its right and left lobes united together by this isthmus. That is a rough outline that this gland is going to take. The seventh peak at the site at the neck, it's going to reach. Then its histrogenesis starts, that is, in the third month, the follicles start to appear. The follicles then start to produce the colloid, and this occurs, that is the structure. We'll talk about how they are produced. Then this duct, which was the starting from the primordium, that was called as the thyroglossal duct, because this is called the thyroglossal duct, because this is a link between the thyroid gland, and above at the foramen cecum and above, it is linked up with the tongue. So that is why it is called the thyroglossal duct. This duct, if you see in this diagram, is going to degenerate. And at the level of the foramen cecum, it's only going to be the opening there. This is the point where you have the junction of the anterior sutura with the posterior one third of the tongue. This is at that side from where this diverticulum is going to come down. So below it is being attached to the thyroid gland, above it is attached to the tongue. This link is going to finish off. This thyroglossal duct is going to finish off. And the foramen cecum of the tongue, that is going to be just the landmark at that. This is the point where this duct or the diverticulum started. Then extension of this thyroid gland can occur, which will what we call as something in the center, where you see in this protrusion in the center, what we call as the pyramidal lobe. This differentiates from this lower end, if you see, from the thyroglossal duct. This attaches, this pyramidal lobe attaches the above it is going to be attached to the hyoid bone, and below it is going to be attached to the thyroid gland by a muscular strip, what we call, or fibrous or a muscular strip, what we call as levator muscle of the thyroid gland. So if you see this, this is here, the protrusion above is this, the thyroglossal duct, that is the pyramidal lobe. This is just normally it's not there, but it, at times it differentiates into another lobe, that is, you have right and the left lobe and the connecting portion, that is your isthmus. At times, at this isthmus where you have this thyroglossal duct, you have a small protrusion, what we call as your pyramidal lobe. And this pyramidal lobe above is attached to the hyoid bone by a muscle or a fibrous string. That is what we call as levator glandulae thyroidei, or a levator muscle of the thyroid gland. This is called levator because it's going to produce elevation. So that is when the hyoid bone moves on swallowing. That is why a patient of the thyroid gland is called to swallow. And when the patient swallows, because of this attachment or they by this also by this levator glandulae thyroidei and by the attachment of your cervical fascia giving a capsule and then attached above to the thyroid cartilage, this all moves together, and that is why the swelling of the thyroid gland is going to move. So that is why the patient is asked to swallow, and on swallowing, if the swelling moves, it is a diagnostic sign for that it is a thyroid swelling. If you see in this, interiorly is the tongue, and on the side is this thyroglossal duct which is coming downwards. This is going to reach to the level where you have your neck at the level of the thyroid cartilage, and this is going to then divide into two lobes, median and lateral, and the isthmus. Thyroid descends to the junction of the trachea and the larynx. This is the junction of the trachea and the larynx. From the thyroid primordium, you develop a thyroglossal duct, because above it is related to the tongue and below it is going to be related to the thyroid. So that is why this is called the thyroglossal duct. Then the thyroid gland arises endodermal diverticulum from the floor of the pharynx. Thickening in the floor between the first and the second pharyngeal pouches, that is just a recollection. Endoderm evaginates ventrally into the mesoderm to form the thyroid diverticulum. You see in this picture as you go onwards. Then formation of the thyroid glossal duct, this long protrusion, that is the thyroglossal duct. Bifurcation on the tip of this duct forms the isthmus and the lateral lobes in this pinkish that you see. And growth of the duct down to the neck, migration of the thyroid gland down to the level of the neck. This is the area where you have seen divided, that is esophagus and trachea. And then you develop into this, the left and the right lobes and the isthmus. And then this small protrusion upwards is what I was telling you as your pyramidal lobe. So that is what you have. So gland reaches the final position in relation to the larynx and the trachea. So descends from the level of the foramen cecum as thyroid primordium, which is endodermal, extends downwards forming your thyroglossal duct, because it's between the thyroid and the tongue. It reaches downwards to the level of your trachea, where it larynx continues as the trachea. There it divides into its two parts. The central portion is called the isthmus, and you see in this diagram, and the two lateral lobes which are going to develop. And this is the central portion where you have the pyramidal lobe. This is going to have the, it may have the attachment of the thyroglossal duct, and you may have another lobe that is an extension upwards, that is called your pyramidal lobe. This is attached to the thyroglossal duct, and you can have a small slip of fibrous tissue or the muscular tissue, which is called your levator glandulae thyroidi, or the levator muscle of the thyroid, that is attached to this pyramidal lobe. Then how are this, its connective tissue and the parenchyma going to be formed? The endodermal component that is going to form its parenchyma, that is the solid endodermal cells. These epithelial cords, then they are invaded, that is going to form the parenchyma. These epithelial cords are going to be invaded by the mesenchyme, that is the vascular mesenchyme. You know that thyroid gland is an endocrine gland. Endocrine gland secretions are to be poured directly into blood. So you have to have the mesenchyme, which is plenty of blood vessels. That is why we have used the term invaded by the vascular mesenchyme. That is going to form the stroma plus the blood vessels. Cells, then they are going to break up. These cells then form groups, and these groups are going to line a cavity inside, which forms a lumen. This is going to be where you have the thyroid follicles, and these thyroid follicles are going to produce the single layer of cells are going to surround the lumen. And then in the center, you have the groups of cells, then lumen forms, and then the lumen you are going to have. These luminal portion is going to be surrounded by the cells. And in the center, you have the lumen, which is going to produce the colloid, which is called the 11th week, and that is called the thyroid follicles. So your epithelial cords, they are invaded by the vascular mesenchyme, producing your blood vessels and the stroma. And then these cells, they are going to form groups. These epithelial cords, which were initially in cord shape, they're going to form groups. These groups then form a rounded structure, and in the rounded structure, you have a lumen in the center. This lumen structure cell is going to be surrounded by a single layer around it, whether it's what you have studied as the simple cuboidal epithelium. This is a follicle which is being formed. That is your thyroid follicle, which is the parenchyma or the functional component of the thyroid gland. This follicle is going to produce colloid, which is called the thyroid follicle, and this is going to produce the colloid. And the vascular mesenchyme is going to produce the network plus your, and I told you it's the reticular fibers which are going to form the stroma of your endocrine glands, and the plenty of the blood vessels which are going to take away your secretions. Then you have something what we call as your parafollicular cells or the C cells. If you remember from the sixth arch, we said nothing is produced except only your parafollicular cells or the C cells, what we call as the ultimobranchial body. So that is being produced, which is also called, the name is also given to this parafollicular cell. So that ultimobranchial body is going to come from your sixth pharyngeal arch. So from the level of the foramen cecum between 1 and 2 arch, there is going to be a outpocketing from the endodermal protrusion that is going to go extend downwards, and then it is going to be called as your thyroglossal duct. This thyroglossal duct is going to go extend downwards till your junction thyroid gland at the cartilage. There it's going to divide into two, producing the isthmus in the center and the two lobes, and maybe at times you have this pyramidal lobe in it. Then when there is the histogenesis, the internal structure. The internal structure is endoderm gives rise to its parenchyma. The parenchyma is split up the cells epithelial into epithelial cord-like cells into this vascular mesenchyme. You have plenty of stroma plus your blood vessels because they have to take away, it's called vascular mesenchyme because they have to take away the secretions via the blood vessels. Then these cells, these cords, they're going to assume a shape of groups. These groups then form a lumen in the center, which are lined by this single layer. And this lumen or the cells, they're called as the thyroid follicles. And these thyroid follicles are going to produce your colloid material. And then next to its wall, they are also going to have some cells, what we call as the parafollicular cells. There is a difference of opinion where there is present. Some say that these are present outside the basement membrane of the follicle. Some say they are present in between the basement membrane of the follicle plus your base of the cell. So for initially they were said that these, so that is why they call the parafollicular cells. So these are also called your C cells or your ultimo because they are being produced from the ultimobranchial body, which was from your sixth arch, pharyngeal arch. So that is the histogenesis of thyroid gland. You have an endodermal component, you have a mesenchymal component, and you have this from the pharyngeal arch, that is your parabrain. So three places where you're getting your contribution. That develops your thyroid gland. The congenital anomalies, let me see. Anomalies which can be there. Congenital hypothyroidism, that is congenitally there is low secretion of the thyroid gland. That is, there is a deranged or abnormal development of the thyroid gland, so its secretion is less. So it is a congenital hypothyroidism because of its some congenital anomaly. Then it can be an ectopic thyroid gland. That is, if I show you a picture, it can be at the lingual level or sublingual thyroid. If you see this picture, this is an ectopic or accessory thyroid. The normal thyroid is position is there at the presence of your upper part of the trachea. This is there, that is the normal thyroid gland is there, but it you may have a small portion or ectopic positions of the thyroid gland. Most common one is the, because it is called the lingual thyroid, because it develops from the junction between the foramen cecum. There the thyroid gland is also developing and your tongue is also developing. So from that area, if small tissue of the thyroid gland is present, that is called the lingual thyroid. If it is slightly lower than that, that can be at the higher level, or it can be the sublingual level. So, or the cervical thyroid if it is in the neck. So these some accessory remnants. They are called normal thyroid is there, but this is the excessive one. If you are having an enlargement of these accessory thyroid glands and you want to remove these, before removing these thyroid glands, accessory ones, you have to be very careful that this is not the only thyroid that the person has. It's just an accessory component and he or she has a normal thyroid. If you remove, considering it as your accessory thyroid gland swellings, you remove that and then afterwards you realize that no, this was the only thyroid. That means the descent, again I told you as we did in the parathyroid glands, that there is descent of these parathyroid glands from the original position down, and they can stop anywhere in between and form the definitive organ. Same is the case with this thyroid. This is developing from the foramen cecum going down till the neck in front of the thyroid gland. So anything can stop on its way and form a definitive thyroid gland. So that would be an ectopic thyroid gland. This can be an accessory. That means the normal is there, but the small thyroid tissues are there. That is called the accessory thyroid. Ectopic would be the thyroid normal does not develop in front of your trachea, but it develops somewhere else. So before removing any thyroid swelling, you have to be very careful, or you have to confirm that this is not the only thyroid that the patient has. He has the normal thyroid somewhere else, and this is just an accessory or an ectopic swelling. Because if you remove this, considering that this is just an accessory thyroid and he or she has a normal thyroid working somewhere on its normal position, you may be wrong. And that means you're making the person go into a condition what we call as myxedema or hypothyroidism. So that is very important. You have to be careful. So that is ectopic. So lingual thyroid is common. That is because it's just at the level of the tongue, and sublingual is slightly at a lower level. Then you can have an that is an ectopic thyroid. You can have an accessory thyroid. That is, normal thyroid is there, but you can have accessory thyroids. That is there. Ectopic is that the normal position of the thyroid is somewhere other than the normal, but accessory is normal gland is present, but you have another small swellings which are working as your thyroid gland. That is the ectopic and the accessory. This because of its position, the lingual and the sublingual thyroids are there. Lingual is more common just underneath the tongue. That is because it starts to descend from there till the level of the neck. Agenesis of the thyroid. It can be no thyroid development at all. Then you have the pyramidal lobe. As I told you, if you see this picture, this is the pyramidal lobe in the center. This is the isthmus and this is the hypoglossal duct. It may persist, which normally should finish off, and it is the protrusion, that is the pyramidal lobe, which is produced there, and the persistence of the thyroglossal duct. Again, this picture shows you the pyramidal lobe. These are the two lobes, left and right lobes of the thyroid gland, and then you have this isthmus, and from this extension upwards, that is what we call as the pyramidal lobe, and this is attached above. The duct is finished off. This pyramidal lobe will be attached to the hyoid bone by the levator gland thyroidy. This is pyramidal lobe. This is an accessory lobe. Then you have a thyroglossal duct cyst, sinus or a fistula, always near on in the midline of the neck, inferior to the body of the hyoid bone, and maybe at the base of the tongue or close to the thyroid duct, because this is at the level where you have your thyroglossal duct. This can become a swelling, a small part does not finish off and it becomes cystic, or it can become an inflamed, that is, it can have a communication on one side, or it can be linking up the inside of the pharynx to the outside, passing through opening in the neck and having an opening outside. Fistula is something that is having an open end at both sides. Sinus is just an open end on one side. The cyst is just a sac-like things with the fluid in it. It can become infected. So this is a thyroglossal duct cyst. Is the difference we saw when we talked about something about the pharyngeal arches. We said that was there on the lateral side in front of your sternocleidomastoid. That was a sinus or a fistula, how you differentiate between the two. This is the central portion because your thyroglossal duct lies in the center. So this fistula, sinus or a cyst will lie in the center of the neck, whereas that was lying just in front on the lateral side of the neck in front of your sternocleidomastoid muscle. So that is the difference. It can be a cyst, it can be a sinus, or it can be a fistula. So this is an accessory one. This is sublingual thyroid. You can see just underneath the tongue, because that is a remnant which is there. That is an ectopic thyroid. That means it did not descend down to its normal position. Then you have this thyroid duct cyst. So it can be recystic again. It can be at anywhere. This is a cervical one. This can be a thyroglossal duct cyst. So they are lying in the center, because they can be a lingual thyroglossal cyst in the sun just underneath the tongue. So these are swellings in the thyroglossal duct, anywhere which is there. This is also showing you the tract that is descending from the foramen cecum up till the neck. So anywhere, if the thyroglossal duct, which has to disintegrate, does not disintegrate, small portion is there, fluid accumulates and that forms a cyst. So it can be anywhere, and the name is given according to the site where it is present. At the hyoid bone, it can be lingual, it can be sublingual, or it can be in front of the larynx. So this is all at the tract of the descent tract of the thyroid gland. You see this, these are the cysts and they lie in the center. The thyroglossal cysts. So the position of the cyst or the swelling or the sinus or the fistula, that differentiates if that it is a congenital anomaly and it is because of what. If it is in the center, it is going to be through this thyroglossal duct cyst, and if it is on the sides, it is because your pharyngeal arches or the pouches, they do not close properly, and you have the cervical sinus or the fistula which was there, or the tonsillar fossa, it does not close completely. So all those places can lead to formation, but that would be on the side in front of your sternocleidomastoid. This is the pyramidal lobe that can occur. and that finishes the development of the thyroid gland. So this is abnormal. Normally you do not have a pyramidal lobe. It can be there, it may not be there. This is a thyroglossal cyst. Hypothyroidism, ectopic thyroid, accessory, agenesis, pyramidal lobe, sinus, duct cyst, all that can be there. We call it the thyroglossal duct cyst because at the level of the Kormann cecum, it is linked up to the tongue above. So that is why we call it the thyroglossal duct cyst. This, both the tongue and the thyroid gland, they are developing from the floor of the pharynx. This gives you a diverticulum downwards and that forms a swelling. That is, they form lingual swellings from the first, second, third and fourth arches forming the tongue. And this was from the sides, that is the descent of your parathyroid and the thymus, that is from the third, the inferior one, and from the fourth you have the superior one that is going to have a lesser descent. The inferior one descends to a lower level and then it's the third, the thymus is going to go down. So you have more abnormalities, more chances of ectopic positions of your third, the inferior thyroid gland, because parathyroid, because it has to travel a longer distance as compared to your superior one. So remembering what part develops from where and remembering the nerve of that arch, you have to mention. You will understand because you get a question, describe the development of the tongue according to its nerve supply. So that is what is meant, that how does a certain part develop and why does it get its nerve supply in that specific area. Just don't remember, okay, you have to just talk about these swellings. You have to, don't forget the fibrous tissue, don't forget the lingual papilla, and don't forget the muscles. That only completes the whole tongue. Okay, thank you. And that was the development of the tongue and the thyroid gland. Next time, inshallah, we'll start with the development of the face.